profitable day, a day of blessing, a day of remembering that God is on his throne. Sometimes I have people call me and they're glum, they're down in the dumps, and I keep telling people this, you know, the earth is still turning toward the east, the grass is still green, the sky is still blue, and God is still on the throne.
Amen.
And I think we need to take courage. Yes, we live in troublesome times, but so did the Apostle Paul when he wrote the words that we are to be rejoicing evermore. And again, I say rejoice. And we live in troublesome times. Well, tonight I'm not speaking about troublesome times. We know they're present with us. But let's look at a text scripture this evening in Matthew chapter 11. And verses 28 and following. And here is a scripture that I want to zero in on. I think we often sort of quote it because it's somewhat poetic. But I want us to grasp the depths of it as it relates to our life and how we live the Christian life. And so as we look at Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, it says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." As I look at these verses, and I look at people who have grown up, as it were, sitting on the benches of a church, they have heard the gospel proclaimed over and over again. They've been to Bible school. They've been in different programs of service. And yet I see some of them still struggling, and they wonder why. Why is it that people who have named the name of Christ still struggle? And as I think of that struggle tonight, I want to take a look at the nature of sin. I want us to get to understand the nature of sin, how it works, how it affects us, even after we have named the name of Christ, and we are attempting to depart from iniquity, but still I think we need to recognize that the nature of sin is still present. What do we do about it? How do we live a holy life when we have this unholy aptitude within us? And so that's been something I've been studying for quite some time as I look at myself and those around me. And so I want to think about the nature of sin for just a bit before we talk about deeper things. I'd like to take you back to Romania, and I walked into a store one day, and there I saw two little dolls. They were about 12 inches tall, and one was dressed like a man, the other dressed like his wife, and they were in traditional Romanian costume. These little dolls represented villages, and something you don't understand is that some of the villages haven't changed in hundreds of years. And so the women all wear a certain type of a blouse with a certain type of embroidery on it. And the men have what looks like a cross between a skirt and short pants. And they have specific costumes for specific villages. And if, for someone that lives there and knows these customs, they can look at a person and see how they're dressed and tell what village they belong to. Now they only wear those for special occasions. So so here's this farmer and his wife. He's got a rake in his hand, or a scythe in his hand. She's got a rake in hers, and like they're dressed in these costumes. But as I picked them up and looked at them, I noticed that their heads were perfectly round and were painted, hers in a feminine style, his more masculine, and I thought that looked strange. And then I noticed that those heads were made of ping pong balls. I said, "Wow, what is this?" So I set them down. Of course, the heads jiggled just a little bit. Then I moved them a little closer together. And all of a sudden, the heads moved. They went, and they kissed. Inside the ping pong balls, there were magnets. Well, that was kind of a surprise to me. We have a magnet within us that is pulling us towards sin. We didn't vote on it. We didn't sign up for it, but we have it. We have something within us that pulls us towards sin, and we better recognize that. And sin has a purpose. And I want you to think for a moment about the cancer of carnality. When I speak about carnality, I'm talking about what the Bible calls flesh, our fleshly minds. We are puffed up in our fleshly minds. Our fleshly minds will take us in areas we don't want to go. Our flesh desires sin. It wants to be gratified. It wants to have its own way. It wants to have its own pleasure. It doesn't want to bend or bow to my own will or anyone else's, not even God's will. It doesn't want to bend to God's will. And the cancer of carnality, I call it that because it has a purpose. You know, there's a horrible thing when a person has been having some trouble physically, and it's persistent and it continues for a time, and they finally go to a doctor and he says, well, let's do a CAT scan. And so they do a CAT scan, and the diagnosis comes back, you have cancer. That's a shocking thing. And I'm sure there are people sitting here in this audience tonight that has had that happen to them. They claim that every fourth person sitting around you tonight will at some point hear those words from a doctor. You have cancer. Now, cancer is never satisfied just to sit at one spot. I have a sister-in-law who had a little nodule on her tonsil. And it bothered her when she swallowed, you know. So she went to a doctor. The doctor examined it and said, I don't think there's anything to worry about. We'll watch it for a couple of months. See what happens. And so she comes back in 2 months and she gets me, he said, it's grown. It's bigger. It's definitely bigger than it was. We need to take a biopsy of that. So we took a biopsy and sent it off to a lab. Several weeks later, he comes back saying, that little nodule is cancer. Now, in the back of your throat, you've got a little cancer there. It's not much bigger than your fingernail. About the size of your fingernail. Or the tip of your finger. Bothers her when she swallows. So they decided that they'll get it taken out. And with that, they took out the entire tonsil, all of it. And but that little nodule would never be satisfied to stay a little nodule. It's not, the cancer is never satisfied just to stay on the tonsil. I mean, if it eat away at the tonsil or build cancerous cells in the tonsil, never go anywhere else, well, you'd live with it. But cancer doesn't operate that. That's not the nature of cancer. Cancer, from that point, would want to go into your larynx, perhaps, or into your throat, and after a while you couldn't swallow. I've dealt with patients that had that problem. And then it would metastasize and want to get up into your brain. Cancer has one purpose, and that is to bring you to death. That's the purpose of cancer. And the cancer of carnality works exactly the same way. It's never satisfied just to keep you proud. It wants to add jealousy to that pride. And then it wants to bring contention in with that pride and that jealousy. And then it wants you to look down at others and think that you're better than they are. And it goes on and on. And it wants to drive a wedge between you and your brethren in your church. And then you become cantankerous. And after a while, you know, it's trying to bring you to spiritual death. It's not satisfied just being on your tonsil. It wants to get into your brain. It wants to get in. It wants to bring you to death. That's what cancer does. And the cancer of carnality works in exactly the same way. You will not find that you have one sin in your life and only one sin. That sin cannot abide by itself. It's got to metastasize over here and grab something else and something else, because it is trying to bring you to spiritual death. And I want you to turn with me to Revelation chapter 20. And I want to take a look at what the Bible calls spiritual death. Revelation chapter 20. And we want to begin reading at verse 11. This scripture has gripped my heart as I think about the finality of the second death. And as we look at verses 11 to the end, it describes what is going to happen. It says in verse 11, Revelation chapter 20, verse 11, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away." So it's talking about the end of time. "And there was found no place for them." Heaven and earth passing away. Incidentally, I talk with lots of people who tell me that life and the universe, it all began with the Big Bang. "Don't you believe in the Big Bang?" I said, "I certainly do." "The Bible promotes the Big Bang. Did you know that?" And he said, "What?" "Yes, it does. It says that the heavens departed with a great noise." That's the Big Bang. I don't know how they got here, whether it was a Big Bang or not, but I know how they're going to leave. Well, here it says that heaven and earth, there was no more place for them. "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened." Now, I don't know what you think about the books. Some people think it's the records of the things that we've done. Maybe. Or it could be the 66 books of the Bible. It may be the Word of God being opened and we judged from those things. And it says, "Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works." The book of life is something that has intrigued me. You'll find it several places in the Bible, and I believe it's something that we need to recognize as the record of who we are and what we are in the sight of God. I believe that's what's found in the book of life. People who are still dead in their trespasses and sins, their names are not in the book of life. The book of life has your name in it only when you come to lay down your sins at the foot of the cross and you allow Jesus Christ to wash your sins away. Then and then only, as the Holy Spirit alivens your spirit so that you can communicate with God, then it's when your name is entered in what I call the birth record of heaven. And when you are born again by the Spirit of God, then your name is entered in the book of life. You're a living individual in the sight of God, spiritually speaking. Then it goes on to say in verse 13, "And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead that were in them, and they were judged, every man, according to their works." And we have people today that think that the grace of God covers their sins. The Bible teaches us that by the grace of God, the blood of Jesus Christ is available to us. And it's the blood of Jesus Christ that washes our sins away. I spoke with a young man, he was 28 years old, and he told me he's a believer. He's a Christian. And we talked for a bit. And after we talked for a while, he said he's got his girlfriend with him. And then after a while, as we talked some more, he told me that they're living together and have been living together for some time. And I said, "Do you realize that the Bible calls what you are doing fornication?" He said, "What do you mean?" He said, "I was saved when I was 14 years old. I said, may I read you a scripture?" He said, "Sure." I opened my Bible to Galatians chapter 5 and said, "These are the works of the flesh: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness." And I read him the whole list and went on to show him that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. He said, "But I was born again back there when I was 14 years old. What are you talking about?" And I had to unlearn him what he had been taught in his church, that the grace of God will cover your sins once you're born again. Not past sins, but present sins and future sins. My Bible tells me that we will be judged according to our works. Isn't that what it says here? It says very clearly that the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead that were in them, and they were judged, every man, according to their works. Our belief has to change our direction of life, because we are born with that magnet in us pulling us towards sin. And if we don't counteract that, we will go that direction. The only way that we can go in a Godward direction is when we are transformed by the power of God. Converted, changed, and become a new creation in Christ Jesus. And when that happens is when we leave sin behind and we embrace God. And I see so many people today who believe somehow they can sin and the grace of God will cover their sins. Every sin that is not washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ will stand against us at the judgment. We cannot take sin with us to heaven. I've asked many a person, which sins do you think you can take with you into heaven? And it's amazing some of the answers I get. People actually think they can. Little sins will go with them. The grace of God just covers them. If you did your banking on that principle, and you just wrote checks, and there was nothing there to cover those checks, I wonder how long you would survive financially. You'd be hauled off to prison eventually. You can't do that. There has to be reality in our Christianity. There has to be salvation that actually saves us from our sins. And then it goes on to say in verse 14, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And that's an awesome thought. You know, I've been a Christian. I've walked with the Lord for a number of years, many years, since I was a teenager. But several years ago, I began reading some of these scriptures, and I began to think within myself, just suppose I would miss it. Just suppose I would not be ready when the Lord calls me home. Just suppose I would get there and hear those horrible words, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you. And I would be cast into hellfire forever and forever with no opportunity of ever, ever coming out of that horrible place. And as I thought of that, it just sort of made me shiver. Just to think of that possibility. And you know, we need to be careful because we are living in a world where ideas are broadcast. Ideas are woven into books that we read, programs that we hear. And those ideas are very subtle. They don't come out and say, I'm going to teach on Calvinism today. They don't talk like that. And they don't express that in a book that they write. But what is written between the lines is something very subtle that we catch without realizing it. And it sort of softens our ideology on God's perspective of sin. Cancer kills. Sin kills. It brings death. It brings the second death. And you and I need to be very careful how we live our Christian life. I've seen people that were what I call clappy Christians. You know, everything's just happy, happy. I wonder what they would do if they would have met up with Jeremiah, the weeping prophet. I wonder how they would have felt if they would have lived at some of the times where the psalmist was writing about his soul that had sinned against the Lord. That soberness that comes with that. And I think we as Christians, we need to be careful Christians instead of clappy Christians. I believe we need to take seriously our walk with the Lord. I am absolutely sure that when God sent Jesus Christ to this earth, it was a serious matter. Oh, I believe the angels were rejoicing. Something marvelous was about to take place. They longed to look into it and were able to. The Bible tells us that. But I believe it was a very sober thing. And as Jesus hung on the cross, I just imagined what was going on in heaven. I believe the angels that were looking on couldn't believe what was happening. And they probably glanced back at the throne many a time. Shall we go? We're ready, you know. But God's plan was that Jesus Christ would pay the ultimate cost. And that he would experience death so that you can experience spiritual life. And so it is important that we understand that this is serious business. Our walk with the Lord is something that we cannot just take lightly. I'm going to draw a couple of things on the board. I want you to understand this illustration as we think about our spiritual life. I want, first of all, to look at, unless I get some colors here. I want to draw a circle. And this circle is representative of you and me. And I'd like to call this the body. And then I would like to make another circle inside of that one to show that there's also a soul. And then I would like to draw another one inside of that one to show that we have a spirit. Now, there are people who center their life around a particular thing. And I've seen young men who were body-centric. And by that I simply mean that they were very, very interested in their bodies, and they worked out, and they struggled, and they wanted a couple of things. One of the things they wanted was strength. They wanted strength. They wanted power. They wanted muscle. And so they exercised, and they worked, and they wanted to make their body presentable, something that others would look upon in awe. And so they were body-centric, all right? And then we also find people who are soul-centric. And I think about 90% of Americans are soul-centric. And in soul-centric, and soul-centrism, if I say it right, the soul-centric person has the soul in mind, and that has reason. That's one of the things that they major in. The other one is emotion. And they sort of worship and serve reason and emotion. They're soul-centric. And then we have people who are spirit-centric, and they have Christ. They have the Holy Spirit. And they have all the attributes that come with Christ and the Holy Spirit dwelling in their hearts. Now, what would happen if you had a car and you had the hub of your tire right here? And you started down the road. The reason I'm saying this is because I bought a set of tires one time, and I went down the road, and the backs of my seats were going like this the whole time I'm driving. They're just wiggling away. And I took them to get them rebalanced. And they balanced them real good, and I went down the road, and they were still doing this number. And I went back to where I bought them, and finally they told me what was wrong is the wheels were not round. They're elongated. You can balance all you want to, and you can put them on a machine and balance them so they spin perfectly. But when you put them on the ground, the axle is bumped up and down, every time that longest portion goes around. And here's what happens. When a person is soul-centric, they're going to have a rough ride through life. It's not going to be smooth. Because reason and emotion cannot get you where you want to be. But most people, they live in the realm of the soul. They do not live in the realm of the spirit. And so they are soul controlled. They're soul centric. And I want us to examine ourselves and see if we are truly spirit centered people. Now, we have a human spirit. And in our human spirit is where the Holy Spirit wants to dwell. Yes, the Bible says the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And that's true. It's also the temple of the soul. It's also the temple of the mind, the will, the emotions, and all that we contain is contained within the body. But we need to understand that unless we have allowed the Holy Spirit to enter into our spirit, until that happens, our spirit cannot communicate with Almighty God. We have a spirit that has been deadened by sin. It is insensitive to God. It cannot relate to God. It cannot communicate with God unless it is through repentance. When a person comes to repentance and they repent of their sins, then the Holy Spirit moves in and dwells in our spirit. And the Holy Spirit speaks to our spirit and it tells us what is right. It tells us what is wrong. It tells us the message of God. And it's written in our hearts. And the Holy Spirit begins to speak to our soul and tell our soul what we need to know, how we need to live, what we need to realize is wrong in our lives. And we hear the Word of God. How do we apply the Word of God? Our soul needs to absorb that. Our spirit tells us how to live it out in our everyday life. And that's how we overcome this thing of the sinful nature, that magnet that is pulling us toward hell, toward the second death. Now I want you to turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 7. There's a scripture here that I think is often misunderstood, but I think it's something that we need to take a look at this evening. Because in Romans chapter 7, we find the nature of sin being exposed. That magnet that keeps pulling us. Paul is talking about it here. And I'm going to begin reading in verse 14. Romans chapter 7, verse 14, it says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin." Now, I sort of tore that apart and did a little study on it. Number one, this word carnal is actually sarx, S-A-R-X in Greek, and it means the fleshly inclination that is within us, or the carnal nature, if you please, the sinful nature. "For we know that that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin." That idea, sold under sin, has the thought that like a slave has been captured. Here's an army. They go over to another country. They fight a battle. They capture a bunch of people. They bring them back, and they're theirs. It is the spoil of war. And in Paul's day, that was often the case. Then they would sell those slaves to whoever they wanted to. And this is the imagery it's talking about here when it says, "I am carnal, sold under sin." So we have been sold to the master of sin. We are children of the devil. As persons are born into this world, yes, we're innocent, but we have that nature, that magnet that is going to pull us towards sin. And as we yield, even in our innocency, as we yield to that, we find ourselves sinning. And we need to be redeemed from that. Now, I remember as a three-year-old boy, that my mother said I had to take a nap during the day, and I thought that was the most ridiculous thing that a mother could ever demand of an active little boy, and the sun was up. Why would I have to sleep? That's just, I couldn't understand it. So I want all you three-year-olds to plug your ears for a moment. But I would take bobby pins and rubber bands with me, and my mother couldn't understand how she was getting holes in her curtains. I knew how they got there, but I never told Mom. One day I looked over and her purse was lying on the floor, and so I went over to it. I thought I could find maybe something in there to sort of amuse myself, and I dug down the bottom and I found it. It was that green pack of double mint gum. Now Mom, if I asked for something, she would give it to me out of her purse, but I knew that that purse was off limits to me. I was not to go into her purse without her permission. So I got out of bed quietly. I tiptoed over there and I dug down in there and I got that double gum. I got one piece out and I, I put it in my mouth and I went back to bed and I'm laying there, you know, thinking, I got one over on Mom. And I was just really enjoying that gum until I heard footsteps coming toward the bedroom door. Now, what do? You know, you got to do something with this. So I go, I got rid of it. Mom comes in the bedroom. She looks around and I'm sound asleep, you know. And she says, Johnny, I don't ask you. And she says it again, more forcefully, you know, Johnny. And that's my mom. I gotta answer. So I said, huh? And she said, were you in my purse? And I go, huh? And she said, were you in my purse? And I know if I said no, that's a lie, so I can't say no. So I said, huh. You see how subtle our minds were? I was trying to deceive my mother, and she was trying to get the truth. I didn't want to give her the truth, but I didn't want an outright lie. But you see how we compromise? Now, I was a little boy, and I don't think that that's on my record in heaven, necessarily, but I was innocent in a way, and yet I knew I was doing wrong. But when you add the years to that, and you find out that we do the same thing on a higher level, we compromise. We just don't want to face the truth. So my mother said, come here. And I got out of bed, tried to rub my eyes, look sleepy, tried to yawn, got over to where she was, and she pointed down at her purse and she said, were you in my purse? And now I'm really pushed, you know. So I said, no, I wasn't in your purse. But my mother had her head very close to mine and timed her breathing so that as I was saying my innocency, she was smelling. She said, you're lying. I can smell gum in your breath. And I was caught. My mother sat me down there and she gave me quite a sermon on the evils of stealing and lying. I never forgot. It made a deep impression on me. But you see, the magnet was already pulling at the age of 3. And as I got older, I felt that pull stronger and stronger in other areas of life. And I yielded to them, and I became a sinner. That's what happened. I literally became a sinner. And my conscience bothered me. I would pray, I would read my Bible, but I wasn't finding peace. Neither was I finding victory. And as we recognize that there is something within us pulling us towards sin, it's important for us to realize that God has a remedy. God has a way of escape that we can escape temptation, we can live in victory, and we are commanded of God by His grace and power to live in victory. So, soul under sin has the idea of we have become a slave to sin. This is hypothetical now. Paul's not talking about himself. He's not talking about the early church. He's just saying this is human life. And verse 15 he's saying, For that which I do allow not, for what I would, that do I not, but what I hate, that do I. I don't know if you've ever found yourself in that situation. I have. Things that I know are wrong, I don't want to do them, and I find myself doing them, I feel guilty, I don't. And then I go back and say, you know, Lord, help me, forgive me, and then I find myself doing it again. And it's sort of an endless cycle. And I think that is typical of many of us in our human existence. And there's got to be a better way. I talk with people that say this. I know I don't live like I ought to, but I always ask God to forgive me. Well, I'm asking them, have you been born again by the Spirit of God? Well, I hope so. They don't know. They hope so. Then I asked them a question. I said, supposing you invited me over to a barbecue at your house, and you had all your friends there, and I'm one of your friends, and I'm there, and I want to go in and use the restroom, and as I went past your coffee table, I saw your wallet lying on the coffee table, so I wonder if this guy's rich, you know. So I opened your wallet, there's $300 in there, and I take them out, stick them in my pocket, put the wallet right back where I got it, I use the restroom and go out, you're none the wiser, and I go home. And my conscience bothers me, and I think to myself, well, you know, that really wasn't right, but I need that money. I got my rent coming due and my car payment. I really need that money, and I need it more than he does. So, but my conscience bothers me. So I said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to run down to the casino. I'm going to invest that money. I'm going to double that money. I'll pay him back. So I run down to the casino, and you know what happens? I lost it all. Yeah. And then I tell these people this. Now, I'll come back to you a week later, and I say, you know what, Tony? Did you miss money out of your wallet? Yeah. I said, Tony, it was me. I took it. And I want you to please forgive me. I needed that money, and I thought I would just use it in the casino. I would win back what I took from you, and I'd pay you back. But I lost it, and I don't have it. Can you please forgive me? And Tony, out of the goodness of your heart, you just forgive me. Okay, 3 weeks later, I happened to be walking past your house, and I noticed that the back door of your car is not locked. I crawled in and hop over the front seat, and I look in the cubbyhole, and wow, you got some nice stash of cash there. So I helped myself to $200, and now I say I'm going to be real careful at the casino because I got to win back $500 now. And so but I lost that too, Tony. Can you please forgive me? And Tony, this goes on and on and on. And I keep stealing from you, but I keep asking for forgiveness. How long is it going to take before you finally figure out that I'm not sorry for stealing? I think it wouldn't take you very long. You sound like an intelligent person. And Tony said, yeah, I guess so. I said, now put it in God's perspective. Here you are. You're sinning over and over again. Same old sins. And you keep coming back to God and saying, God, just forgive me. Please forgive me. And you know, God is gracious. God wants to forgive you, but he wants to cleanse you. He wants to change the direction of your life. He wants to redeem you from the power of sin that makes that magnet pull. That's what he wants to do. And I share that with people, but I think we need to grasp that as well. That salvation is not running back to God, asking for forgiveness over and over and over and over again, and never being redeemed from the power of sin. God wants his children to be obedient children, living not after the flesh, but after the Spirit of God. And so we need to understand the cancer of carnality, though it be ever so small to begin with, is out there to bring a person to spiritual death, the second death that we read about. Now, the Apostle Paul is saying here in verse 17, now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. That carnal nature that is in me is what's causing this repeat sinning. And then he goes on and he flips it around in verse 18, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, sarx again, that is our fleshly nature, carnal nature, sinful nature, in that dwelleth no good thing, for to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. I know what I ought to do, but I don't have the power to do it. And he goes on in verse 19 to say, for the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. And it's a horrible bondage for folks that are still living this kind of a life and claim to be a Christian. He goes on to say in verse 20, now if I do that, I would not. It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. I suppose most of us can relate to that, can't we? When I want to do good, I find evil right there at the door. I feel that magnet pulling in the opposite direction. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. I have something here deep down inside of me that wants to do right. But my soul and my body is against that will to do right. And I find it overpowering, and I find that I'm doing wrong. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. And then he says something that for many years astounded me. Why, after all this explanation, does he say, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Why does he say body of this death? What is he talking about? How does that relate? Then I read something and it all fell into place. It's like you were working on a puzzle and you had pieces that you just didn't know where they went, and all of a sudden you see it, there they are, and the picture is finished. When Paul penned these words, he knew that the people of Rome would understand. Rome was spread out around the world. And there were primitive cultures that took punishment into their own hands. Years ago, I was in Dolores, Belize, southern Belize, in the Toledo district. And I came to an Indian village there, and they had a longhouse. That was their meeting place. And in the middle of that longhouse was a post that went all the way up and connected to the framework. And it was dug deep in a hole and anchored there. And then they told me that when a man gets drunk and beats his wife, they take him to that pole, they put his hands behind the pole, and they tie him fast behind the pole so he can sit down and he can stand up, but that's all he can do. He can't leave. And that's his punishment for 3 days, because he beat his wife, got drunk and beat his wife. Now, if his wife doesn't come to him and give him a drink of water, he goes without water. If she doesn't feed him, he goes without food. I think he would think several times before he pulls that the second time. Because if his wife is still mad at him for being beat up, she just won't feed him. And so primitive cultures had a way of dealing with wrong. The Apostle Paul knew that when he cried out this agonizing cry, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the power or from the body of this death?" They knew that he was talking about when a man in this primitive culture killed another man, killed his neighbor, they would take the corpse of that neighbor he had murdered and lay him down and lay the corpse on his back and chain it fast in such a way that he could not get loose. He could stand up, he could walk around, and if nobody fed him, he went without food. If nobody gave him water, he went without water. And for days, he walked around with this dead man on his back. And eventually, that dead man bloated, and then his skin burst, and the fluids from his body began to eat away at the back of the man who murdered him. And the infection would slowly eat away into his flesh, and eventually bring him to death. A horrible death. And the Apostle Paul is alluding to that when he cries out and says, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" And here's why. Because you and I have, as it were, the fleshly nature chained within us and we can't kick it out. Self doesn't have the ability to kick self out of self. We have to reach to something higher to overcome. And the blood of Jesus Christ was sacrificed for us to cleanse us from all sin, to bring us into a right relationship with God. And when a person has the blood of Jesus Christ applied to their life, this spirit that could not communicate with God suddenly becomes alive because the Holy Spirit enters and raises it to newness of life. And the Holy Spirit can now communicate with Almighty God. So when you are born again by the Spirit of God, you have the ability now to communicate with God. You can receive His impressions upon your heart and life. Not only that, but the Holy Spirit is giving you a knowledge of right and wrong, and it's giving you the power to resist temptation. And as you know right from wrong, you resist temptation, guess what? You begin living the Christian life. You begin living in victory. You become an overcomer. And these things that the Apostle Paul is talking about change. And I want to tell you why. Because God reaches up inside of you and He turns the magnet around. Have you ever tried to take two magnets when you turn them around and try to push them together? They won't go together. You can push and carry on and they'll just slide sideways, but they don't want to go together. You've reversed the polarity. And that's what God does to us. And if we allow Him to, He will turn that magnet around to where sin becomes repugnant to us. We don't want it. It is hateful to us because we realize it will mar the relationship between us and our God. We don't want that. And I sometimes illustrate it this way. My wife and I have been married for almost 50 years. And I ask people that I talk to on the phone, do you think in the 50 years that we've been married that I never saw another woman that didn't pull? Do you think I never in 50 years saw a woman that wasn't beautiful and attractive and I sensed a pull? Yes, I have. What do you do with it? Stomp on it. Why? I'm not about to let that come between me and my wife. Put it in a spiritual perspective, it's the same way. We will not allow that sin, the allurement of that sin, to come between my Christ, my God, and my soul. That's victory. When we hate sin, and we need to see sin in the same light that God does, and we need to hate it with the same vehemence that God hates it. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? And he answers the question in verse 25, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I don't know about your Bible, but I got a period after the Lord. That's the end of the sentence. He's saying the deliverance from the body of this death is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Then he has a footnote to it. He says, so with the mind, with my heart, my spirit, my soul, my body, my all, I'm going to serve the Lord, but there's still that fleshly nature working against me. And we need to understand that. We're not on easy street. And so many believers have an experience like I had early in my Christian life. You know, once in a while my dad would come home and he'd have something special for me. I remember one time it was a slinky. They were playing with a slinky and get them going down the steps. One time he came home with a yo-yo. You know, and you go down. And I used to like to make it so it would sleep. When it got to the bottom, it would just sit there and spin. And I'd give a little jerk and up and come again. Down and up, down and up. A lot of Christians have that kind of a Christian experience. An up experience for a while, and then down they go again. And they sit down there and just kind of spin. It takes a little twitch from God to get them to come back up again. But that's not the way God designed the Christian life to be. I believe God has made all the provision for us to truly be in right relationship with Him continually. Not close and then far, and He's got to jerk our string again. But no, we're to walk with Christ. And it should be a joy to us. And I am so blessed to think that there's no break between Romans 7 and Romans 8 when Paul first penned the words. Because he goes right on into it, says, therefore, because Jesus Christ is the one who will deliver us from the body of this death, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh. That's the same flesh he's talking about up here when he says, I am sold under sin. But I am carnal, sold under sin. That carnality, that cancer of carnality. He's saying, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the carnality of their flesh, but after the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, which is in them. And I am so blessed by that. Now, we need to come to the place where we realize that there is enmity between our sinful nature and God. If we go into Romans chapter 8 and look at verse 7, it says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. I'd like to illustrate this with an experience that I had when I was 16 years old. I had just gotten my driver's license. I worked for Ruth's uncle, who was a mason. I was a tender. And we finished one job in a housing project, and we moved to another one about a mile away. And he told me, he said, look, take the truck. It was a brand new truck. Take the truck, and I want you to take this. There's a jug, a 5-gallon jug of muriatic acid on the back of the truck. Drive carefully. Go over there and wash the face of that fireplace that we finished last week. I want you to wash it off with that muriatic acid. And so I said, okay. And we only had one bucket on the job, and that was the bucket he was using, so I couldn't use that bucket. He said, I asked him, I said, well, what am I supposed to use? Oh, you'll find something over there. Okay. So I drive over there, and I'm feeling really great. This Econoline truck, and here I go. And I got over there to that job, and I looked around for anything that I could put this muriatic acid in, because then I had a brush and a handle. I'm going to brush off this this fireplace face. But he told me, be careful, don't get any of that acid on the cement floor, because it'll bleach the floor. Okay, I'm going to be very careful. So here I am. I'm feeling really important, because he's giving me a job on my own, driving his truck. And I get over there, and you know, the only thing I could find that hold muriatic acid was the cat bowl. Well, I took the cat bowl and I cleaned the crumbs out of it, and I went inside and I set it down, and I walked in with that glass 5-gallon jug of muriatic acid, carefully took the top off, and I poured it, look, about half full. And then I wanted to get this jug out of there, because I didn't want anything to happen to the floor. I walked out, set the jug down, put the plug in the top, and I walked back in, and the room was full of steam. And I didn't know what was going on. And underneath the steam, I could see bubbles coming up out of that pot. And I reached down to grab it, and it was so hot, it burned my hand, and I dropped it. And now I'm thinking, oh no, the acid's going to go all over the floor. But there was no acid in it. It had all vaporized. There was enmity between cast aluminum pots and muriatic acid. I found that out the hard way. And you couldn't reconcile the two. There's no way you can make muriatic acid settle down and behave itself in a cast aluminum bowl. It will not work. There is enmity there. There is a diabolical difference. They cannot function together. I say diabolical. But here is something I want us to understand. The carnal mind is enmity against God. And it says here, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. It doesn't say it may not be subject to the law of God. It says it cannot be. Your carnal nature is never going to lay down and just give up and say, okay, God, you got me. Your carnal nature is never going to do that. So your carnal nature is going to be alive, watching for an opportunity to trip you up. It's still there. And it doesn't have the ability to submit itself to God. But here's what happens. When the Holy Spirit is dwelling within your spirit, it gives you life. That's where eternal life begins. It gives you life. And that life is going to continue as long as you walk with the Lord. And it's going to tell your soul how to operate. It's going to tell your soul that this is sin. This allurement that I feel, this desire that I feel, this covetousness that I have, this self-centeredness that is sin, I can't go there. I must delete that. I must have victory over that. And the only way I can have victory over that is by walking in the Spirit. When we walk in the Spirit, the Bible says, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And so by walking in the Spirit, we become overcomers. We become victorious. We become true disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is what I need. That's what you need. Now I'd like to turn to Hebrews chapter 12. We have one scripture there I want to look at. Hebrews chapter 12. After listing all those faithful people in the 11th chapter, we come now to the first chapter, the first verse in chapter 12, where it says, wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about by so great a cloud of witnesses. And it sort of has this idea, like You are running a race, and the grandstands are around you. And it's those faithful men in heaven, those faithful ones who have finished the course, and they're there sort of like watching us as we continue to run the race. And he's saying, we're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. And let us run with patience or endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Beloved, if you want to make it to the right hand of the throne of God, you're going to have to do like Jesus did. You're going to have to be able to lay aside all that would hinder you from being successful in your Christian life. Any sin that is a besetting sin that we deal with over and over again, we need to lay it aside. We need to overcome it. Jesus expects us to overcome it and has made all the provision that you and I need in order to overcome it. In Romans chapter 12, verse 1, it says, I beseech ye therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And I find so many people, they say, I just wish I knew God's will for my life. I think here's the key. Here's the key. They need to be transformed by the renewing of their mind, and they will find God's purpose for their life. And that's what is so necessary for you and for me. I want to go back now to Matthew chapter 11 and wrap this up, if I may. In Matthew chapter 11, it's telling us, once again, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And it's giving us to understand that to carry a load of sin, to carry a burden of defeat, to carry that thing in our life where the magnet is constantly just pulling and pulling, and we try to resist it, but we haven't allowed God to get up there and turn the polarization around. Yeah, we will always live with temptation, but there is victory in Jesus. Take my yoke upon you. See, many of us want to come and find that rest, but even then there's something else that goes with it. Take my yoke upon you. That word yoke means a coupling, or you're working in tandem. Jesus Christ is helping you bear that load. Jesus is there to lift that heavy load. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. In Romania, you often saw a horse pulling a wagon, and tied right beside the mare was her colt. And the colt, I've seen new colts tied for the first time, and they're jerking at the straps, and they're trying to get loose, and oh mama, she just keeps plugging down the road, you know. And after a while, Junior, it's either get dragged or fall in step, you know, and Junior, he learns to fall in step. And so it is with you and me. You know, there's something in us that resists walking in the footsteps of Jesus. But the Bible says we are to walk as he walked. And so we need to take his yoke upon us, be coupled with him, and learn of him. Then he says, I'm meek and lowly of heart. That means that God in Jesus Christ condescends to be on your level. He's right there with you. He's not aloof that you can't reach him. He's right there. And I keep telling people, you know, God wants you in heaven. God wants to save us. God wants to see us in victory. God desires all of his children to live a holy life and join him in heaven. That's the purpose for sending Jesus Christ. And as we walk in the Spirit, that will become a reality to us. And so it's important for me to learn of him and that he is right there with us. He's lowly and meek of heart. We must also be lowly and meek of heart, realizing that we can fall, realizing that it is by his grace that we continue and we stand. And it says, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. Twice in these three verses, we find that ye shall find rest unto your souls. And that rest, has the idea of a cessation or a stopping or a, it even uses the word recreation in describing it. It's like the Greek word has that connotation that we are relaxing in Jesus, and we shall find rest to our souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And so tonight, as we think of the yoke of Christ, it is the answer to a sincere, faithful walk of victory from here to glory. I need that. You need it. May we seek God and find it. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord God, as we come before you at the end of the service, we want to commit each one here to you. We pray, dear Father, that you would help us to realize that we need to truly search our hearts, see if there be any wicked way in us. If there are those besetting sins that have tripped us up over and over again, and we're not living in full victory, oh God, tonight I pray that we would make that decision to face the reality of it, to come to Jesus Christ in a new way. If there's an area of life, Lord, where we have missed the mark and we have sinned against you, I just pray, Lord, you would give us the courage to acknowledge it and come to you, to allow your grace to minister to our hearts and bring us to a new level of Christian victory. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.